Here's the objective. Create a security that mimics the exact return of a plain Bagel Co. share, using only derivatives and non-stock investments. To achieve this, we'll need a series of securities that, when combined, replicate the following graph, whereby we earn a dollar return for every dollar increase in the stock's price. A fair warning that this exercise will get a little technical and complex at times, but it will show you just how capable and how comprehensive the world of options truly is. So let's go over the synthetic stock and how we can make one on today's Plain Bagel. A synthetic stock is exactly what it sounds like. A security that looks like and acts like a stock, but is actually made up of other investment securities. Typically, investors will use European options, or options that can only be used on expiration, to make up the security. And the best way to understand how these investments replicate a stock's return is to graph their return characteristics, with the goal of netting out the graphs to achieve the same straight line relationship that the stock has. So, let's begin. The first thing we want to do is to somehow replicate the upside of the stock, the right side of the graph pointing upwards. This is easy enough to do if we buy a call option, a security that earns you money if the stock's price increases. Now, I'm not going to focus too much on the numbers here, but they are important. So here are the stats for the chosen call for reference. A reminder that the strike price is the price you can pay to acquire the underlying stock at expiration, and the premium is the price you pay to acquire the option. We're going to set the strike price equal to the current stock price, for simplicity. So we've got our upside, and the only downside we have is the premium we paid for the option. Now we want to replicate the downside of the stock's return. And we'll do that with a put, which we'll assume has the same stats as the call. Though a quick note that the premium will be slightly different than the call premium, something we'll explain later on. Graphing the put, it's clear that the slope is facing the correct side, but going the wrong direction. However, if you remember from the options video, we can actually invert the slope if we take a short position on the option. In other words, we are going to sell a put option, promising another investor that, should they choose to do so, we will buy a stock of Plain Bagel Co. from them at the predetermined strike price in 3 months. This means that rather than paying a premium, we actually earn a small amount from the other investor, hence why our upside is limited to the premium we receive. So let's take a moment to combine what we have so far.
On the left side of the strike price, adding the cost of our call premium and the money we'd lose on our put will pull the line down slightly. This is because when the stock's price ends up below our strike price, we lose money on both of our positions. The call option we purchased becomes useless, and since we sold the put option, we'll have to buy the stock at the put strike price, even though it isn't worth that amount. The opposite is true on the other side of the graph. If the stock's price increases, we'll make money on our call option and keep the premium of the unused put option. So when we combine the slopes on the right side of our strike price, we shift our call line upward and
ta-da! We have a graph pretty close to our underlying share. And for most investors, this is surely good enough, but it is a little off. Why? Well, remember what I mentioned about the put having a slightly lower premium than the call. Because the two are slightly different, we are paying more than we are receiving from the put, meaning that regardless of the stock's performance, we will always have a return slightly below the stock's return. So, why are the premiums between the call and the put different? Well, the reason has to do with the time value of money and something called the cost of carry. It's kind of a complex topic to explain in a short video, but the easiest way to think of it is to assume that the writer of the call option is holding on to the Plain Bagel Co. shares to meet their obligation to us as owners of the call. Because the option writer has money invested in these shares, which they may need to forfeit at some point, they basically don't get to keep whatever return they earn from the shares. In other words, for the duration of the option's life, the option writer has money sitting around in an investment that can't earn a proper return. So to compensate the call writer for this deadweight investment, the call option premium incorporates a bonus equal to the risk-free rate of return, or the minimum amount an investment needs to compensate you for, that will pay the option writer for the return lost over the duration of the option's life. So when we have a put and call both trading at the money, like we do in our example, the call option will often have a more expensive premium than the put option. With that intense explanation out of the way, let's go back to our graph. We now know that the difference between our return and the stock's return is equal to the cost of carry, in this case, the risk-free return, that we are paying to the call option writer. So to get back the risk-free return, we can buy what's called a zero coupon treasury bill, which is a proxy for the risk-free return. So let's say that we find the following zero coupon treasury bill.
you'll notice that if we buy the bond, we bring the total amount we are investing, that is how much we are paying for our options and our bond, up to $30. The same amount we'd need to pay for a plain Bagel Co. share. So now our synthetic investment has the same price as the share it is copying. Progress! But now let's make sure that the returns match up as well. The return graph for the T-bill is as follows. Seems odd, right? But it makes sense. Because a risk-free bond's return is just that, risk-free. It's a guaranteed amount that's independent of the stock's movement. So if we combine our risk-free zero coupon bond to our call and put option positions, we shift our line upwards and boom, we've done it. We've created our synthetic stock, an instrument that perfectly matches the return characteristics of a plain Bagel Co. stock. Pretty neat, isn't it? But why would someone go through all this trouble just to copy a stock? Well, investors who make synthetic stocks often do so when they believe there is a mispricing in a stock's options. Maybe the call price offered by an option writer is actually lower than it should be. And so investors will take this position to take advantage of the arbitrage opportunity, thereby achieving a higher return. But truthfully, for the average investor, this isn't very useful knowledge. And we've grossly oversimplified the concept. Nonetheless, I think it's pretty interesting stuff. I mean, just think about it for a moment. Someone with no ownership of a company, no underlying shares, can earn money from its success as though they own stock in the firm. Now, rest assured, moving forward, I'll get right back to investment basics. We aren't changing to an option strategy channel. But as a huge finance nerd, the topic was hard to resist. Thanks for watching. Did you find this useful, interesting, stupid? Let me know in the comments down below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for notifications of future videos. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.